We have a duty to live loudly so that future generations get to be quiet. They get to just exist.
If you're too gay, you're not black enough. If you're too black, then you're not gay enough. I feel like I can chew gum and walk at the same time.
I'm not going to make myself feel uncomfortable because someone's uncomfortable about me. That's a you problem. That's not a me problem, boo.
Welcome to Informal, a new show brought to you by Beats by Dr. Dre, which will see me, Dotty, joined by some of the best talent in and around Black British culture. On today's episode, I'm joined by two people that are very, very special to me personally. Singer, songwriter, producer, MNEK, and model, activist, and all-round game changer, Munroe Bergdorf. Thank you so much for joining me, guys.
Thanks.
We've got a lot to unpack today, guys. Loads. Because I don't think there's nearly enough conversations being had about Black, queer, or just non-traditional identities in Britain. But let's talk about visibility first, because I think that's part of why these conversations are so necessary and why I think we have to live loudly. I sometimes think we have a duty to live loudly so that future generations get to be quiet. They get to just exist. And they can just be trans quietly, or they can be gay quietly, or queer quietly, because we were loud enough about it when change needed to come. But I think visibility plays an important part in that, because I didn't have many people that I could look to when I was a young Black gay teenage girl. There was Ellen, and then there was like Queen Latifah in like Cleo in Set It Off. I remember watching Set It Off and being like, the mood board. Goals, like finally. Munroe, you kind of, your role now to many young trans women, teenagers, children, is a role that you didn't have to look to when you were growing up. So do you feel the weight of responsibility that you are now a role model?
I don't see myself as, you know, I don't try to be that. I just try to be as authentic as possible and remind people that, you know, a role model is not a perfect human being. It's it's a fully formed person that is trying to do their best. And I make mistakes just like everybody else, but I like to think that it's really about how you acknowledge those mistakes and grow from them. You know, there's a thousand things that I regret. And I don't look up to people that are perfect. I look up to people that are flawed, that that grow. And everybody, you know, that I looked up to as a kid was massively flawed and controversial as well, because my identity is inherently controversial. You know, stepping into a room in the beginning of my transition, people would stare at me for no reason other than the fact that they didn't understand. Like, I knew who I was at that point and I wanted to be who I was, but they would stare at me because of what they didn't understand. Things are only controversial until they're not. And then once you take away the shame that's attached to something, it leads to progress because we're able to talk about things.
So do you feel like we need to be the controversial ones now?
Yeah, I would say so. You know, I mean, when I was growing up, you know, a kiss between two men on EastEnders was the talk of the town. And like now, two men kiss on EastEnders and it's not even a thing. You put the kettle on. Do you know what I mean? It's really not that much of a thing. And it's just exposing people to imagery that they haven't seen.
MNEK, I want to talk to you as well about whether you feel that responsibility of being seen, if you feel that you have a duty now to fulfill that role of role model.
I tell you what, I think I felt this need when I was releasing like my solo record a couple years ago. I felt the need to be like this martyr or like this person of like great importance to the Black queer community. But no, I think it's more like, I don't know. I feel like my actions do that more. I think when I'm being myself and when I'm not worried about the way it looks, I think a lot of people find a lot of comfort in that. And I think that, you know, with the work that I've done over the years, a lot of the things have been for, you know, white female artists. You know, I guess it's very linear, and maybe like sometimes it's not seen as a thing of, okay, I'm doing this really black gay thing like I was going for with my album. And when I did that, I was so strong on it, and I saw the impact of it. You know, I've tasted success from a very commerce point of view and seen how it can affect the everyday person. It's great when the songs are able to communicate with people, but then when my existence is able to communicate to people where they feel compelled to message me and be like, thank you for just being you. I think your songs are great, but I thank you for being you. As a result of the commercial success I've had from the masses, I would sometimes forget that and think about, okay, but I'm not selling a million trillion records, so is it reaching the people? But when you go to a concert and you see a black gay kid and they've found solace in what you're doing, it's a different type of success. It's a different measure, but it's 10 times as valuable.
Just by existing, we're making a statement. If I post a picture of myself and my wife and my Instagram, or I post a picture of me and my children, it's like I'm being provocative without that even being my attention. Mm. It's like people say we're pushing an agenda, right? Just by existing. Do we need to push an agenda though? Like maybe the quote unquote agenda is a necessary part of the journey.
I definitely think that we're promoting an agenda. And I think that it's, you know, ultimately we've been living underneath the heterosexual agenda. You know, it's all an agenda. We've been living underneath the white supremacist agenda. We've been living underneath the transphobic agenda. The homophobic agenda was literally what me and Uzo grew up in, you know, and G.T. So it's, I think it's about changing the language and, you know, saying that we're just pushing an agenda. Of course, that's what we're doing. You know, it's the agenda that we don't want future generations of queer youth to hate themselves like we did when we were kids. You know, I mean, I can't speak for you two, but I had to work through so much shame with regards to my sexuality, with regards to my gender identity and my race. Because I was consistently told that those things weren't beautiful, that those things weren't as valid, that they weren't acceptable, that they're not something I should be proud of. And it's only, you know, during like my early to mid 20s that I started to figure out, actually, all of this is a projection from other people and there's nothing wrong with me. But it's only really now that people are starting to say that in the mainstream.
You know, it fascinates me when people say you can't show kids gay because they'll want to be gay. If they see gay, they'll flock to it like a light. And I think I grew up, all I saw was the princess going for the prince, and I was never on the prince. Do you know what I mean? So it's funny how everybody kind of wants to bash the queer agenda until it's time to be inspired, right?
I grew up in Catford. I grew up in Southeast London, predominantly black school, Catholic. I was saying some hateful stuff. You know what I mean? I was saying some hateful, homophobic stuff because like that was what my environment was telling me was the thing to do. Mm-hmm. You know, there was no one with the other opinion of being like, well, actually, it was actually just like, this is it. Nigerian household, you go to Catholic church. This is what is teaching that being gay is wrong. And there's not even any room for the conversation, even the exploration.
They're upholding an agenda, like we said. And it's really important that, you know, we teach kids the way that the world is. And not just the way that the world is, but the way that, you know, the world can progress. And realistically, you know, the world is not full of only straight people. And it's okay if you're gay, you know. So to say that we can't teach kids about same-sex relationships because it will make kids gay. So what if it does, you know? And it doesn't, but if it did, then being gay is not a bad thing, you know? It's just like saying that being straight's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. It's just the way that it is. But the fact is that teaching kids about the way that the world is doesn't change them because that's just who they are. People just are gay. People just are trans. You know, teaching leaving out identities, leaving out huge portions mm-hmm. of possibility for who they are is so much more damaging than teaching people about how to respect each other and respect difference. We should be teaching that difference is something to be respected and admired, and yeah. that self-love is an important foundation for the human identity. If you don't love yourself, then you can't love anybody else, but you also find it difficult to respect people. It's not just about love, it's mm-hmm. about respecting people for being who they are. And I honestly think that if we taught about self-love and empowerment from an early age, then we wouldn't have to, you know, be running around like headless chickens wondering why we've got so many problems with bullying in schools. It's because there's a tribal pack mentality in schools that if you see difference, it's taught. Well, it's not necessarily taught, but it's just not
taught
about.
It's definitely taught, by the way. It's definitely taught. I have to disagree with that. I feel like that ideology does not come from nowhere.
Sorry, I meant like it's not taught that difference is... Oh, do you think that people are taught that difference is... like, do you think
I
kids
mean more
are
so
taught?
In the sense
I think that,
that
we just don't talk about it.
More so like the ideology of teasing someone or ridiculing someone for their differences and for what they are. That is taught at home. It's either taught at home, or the notion to do the others, or the notion to do the other thing is neglected altogether. Like,
I agree. It's definitely taught because I've got a son of nursery age, right? And I think it's important sometimes that me and my wife both take him to nursery so that these kids can see. Yeah. Okay, this is a type of family. This is he's got two mums, and there's no ignorance at that age. So any of those children that go on to become ignorant will have learnt that. Do you know what I mean? There's in his group of friends that are three and four, they're just like, okay, this is what it is. He's got two mums. Yeah. It's not. So that is definitely something that is taught.
Yeah, I think that it's exacerbated by the fact that it's left as well. I don't necessarily know if I think that it's actively taught. I feel like because we don't talk about it, they teach each other that. And then there's that pack mentality of, you know, that's someone's that's different. Let's pick on them because we haven't generated self-love within ourselves. So I'm going to pick on them before I'm picked on. But if we teach kids how to love themselves and how to generate self-empowerment, then there's less need to form all of these packs. And we can see difference as something that is unifying rather than something that separates us.
Fully. Love that. I want to talk about the impact of queer communities, right? Because I was saying everybody likes to bash the queer agenda until it's time to be inspired or until it's time to go shopping and buy some designer. Do you know what I mean? Like one time I was in a barbershop and there was a guy in there and he was just talking some nonsense about something gay. And I was like, you're wearing Alexander McQueen's, bruv. Like on your actual feet. Do you know who Alexander McQueen is? And there's this thing, particularly in the black queer community, where we have such a huge impact on popular culture, music, fashion, slang. Often people don't even realise that these things are coming from us. MNEK, you must see that every day.
I really, really, really do. I mean, it goes back to what I was saying. You grow up in these environments that don't respect homosexuality as a black thing. Because that's the thing. A lot of people think that homosexuality is a very Caucasian mindset, which is crazy, which is like actual lunacy. Like, it goes and spreads across everybody. The conversations I've had with certain people who look like me, but maybe don't live like me, about homosexuality have lacked nuance and have lacked like real understanding, because it's like we were saying, there's so many things that will just pop up, like, you know, even these straight guys saying tea and shade and like all these things, like this is black gay culture, like black queer culture, like has built this vernacular. And so it seeps into everything where you cherry pick what you like, but then you leave the rest. But actually you've got to realize all of that comes with that. The shade, the tea, all those have been used as tools to laugh instead of cry. You know what I mean? Like, that's literally the case. Like, I find it offensive, but then I think it comes from ignorance and a lack of awareness of just the origin of it and the pain that people like myself, like Munroe, and people before us have experienced in different ways. Like, I remember there was a point when I may have said something about black straight men, and I've been a whole thing about, you know, I just didn't feel like there was a support there, system there, or there was a conversation being had about how there's no black queer artists out here, there's no template here. I felt shunned, you know what I mean? Don't know if it was just, but I felt shunned. And all of these things like, ooh, look at the tea, ooh, look at the shade, and it's like, I was getting so much homophobic abuse from all of that. And it was crazy because it was all from people who looked like me.
Right.
And like, I think that sucks as far as like intersectionality, like being, having to grapple with the fact that if you're too gay, you're not black enough. If you're too black, then you're not gay enough. Like, it's very peculiar because I feel like I can chew gum and walk at the same time. I can be both, like, I can be both and be rich in both parts of myself as each other and not one negates the other. And all I can say is that the dream is to be able to do that freely. And people asked me to be able to do that freely as well.
I want to talk about that because you were very vocal after your album came out, as you say, where you mentioned feeling let down by straight black men for not supporting the project. Do you, now that time has passed, do you look back on that and still feel that way?
Black straight men were never going to go towards something that wasn't geared towards them. So, and I think it goes back to what I was saying earlier about my relationship with success. And that changing, you know, I can't expect anything from anyone. All I can expect is that I'm putting my best foot forward and that it is reaching the people that it appeals to. And that album was a love letter to black queer men and women. But of course, it's like, it's hard. Like, you know, when I was promoting that album, I really wanted to get it out to people who look like me, but I was performing to a lot of Caucasian crowds. And like, it's the part and parcel of like the industry. I feel like I had a lot of thinking to do and a lot of, and there was no template for me to find out how to maneuver this or how to deal with my own insecurities about lack thereof, like commercial success. You know,
was that more to do with, because I think at the time you were looking outwardly, right? You were looking towards the audience and where you sat in terms of their acceptance. When you look back on it, do you feel that you were navigating that through their eyes more than your own? Because it felt as though you were kind of looking at how your album was received through the people that weren't looking at it, as opposed to the people that were receiving it. And do you think that speaks to how you felt about acceptance at the time?
100%. I mean, it's like, this is something, you know, the outward is always a reflection of the inward, you know, it's
right,
always
like
the insecurities that you feel. And, you know, that was a reflection of the fact that I just wanted to be seen by people who look like me. And
right.
I think that it's hard being revered by white people, actually, because it's like, they're there and they appreciate you and it's mass, but then it's like the cultural part of it is tricky because it's like they see this as fun and dress up and all of this, but this is your life. Like, this is the way you exist every day. And there's paler, what's the word? Contemporaries as well. You know what I mean? There's people who are out there who probably adhere closer to their wants and needs. So, like, there's also that insecurity as well.
It's so similar to, you know, the playground, all of these, like, Instagram sites that are very focused towards the black community, which is literally just opportunities to tear down other black people coming from black people. It comes from self-hate, I believe. It comes from the fact that we are taught to hate ourselves, so we end up hating each other. If you're a minority in the UK, it's hard enough. But then if you're minority of a minority, then you're fighting your own people as well as wider society. So I completely 100%. Sympathize and empathize and understand, you know, where Uzo is coming from, because I mean, I get the same thing. You know, I get people that, you know, I'm fighting for the equality of all people, regardless of who you are, not just, you know, black people, but everybody. And I'll actively have people from my own community will be the worst to me. And it's, I know where it comes from, because it's misdirected anger and internalized hatred. Because the reality is that happy people who know who they are and happy people who understand that our purpose as human beings is to leave the world better than we found it, they don't actively try to squash other people's spirits. And the only people that do that are people that have had their own spirit squashed. And I really do feel like the best way that we can counter that is if we encourage empowerment and intersectional empowerment. And, you know, we see black women uplift everybody, but they're still squashed by black cisgender men, straight men. So I really feel like we need to do a lot of work when it comes to the masculinity within the black community, because it's really affecting the more marginalized identities within the black community.
Do you know what? I think that's such a powerful point that you make, and you articulate it so well when it comes to being black and queer and sometimes feeling that you are at odds with people that look like you. I don't think I've even myself looked at it in that way, which is crushing others because you have been crushed by society. Institutions have crushed you.
That's the way that I can deal with it, because I know, like, I've got so many straight male friends, straight black male friends, and I can understand them because they understand me, because they see me as a human being. But when, you know, I am in a room with black men and I can actively see that I make them uncomfortable, I can sympathize with it because I can see that they're uncomfortable. I'm not uncomfortable, you know? Mm. That's, they're making it a me problem, but it's a them problem. And I feel like we need to empower and educate the ones with the most power in the community, which are straight black men. Because the reality is that straight black men are not making it easy on black women, on gay black men, on black trans people. We need to, you know, utilize the people in the community that have the most power. And also that comes down to education, because, I mean, we hear a lot about how, you know, homosexuality is a white thing, when the reality is that homophobia is a white thing. You know, homophobia has literally been, it wasn't a thing in so many places in the world until the British Empire exported it and imposed Christian values on, you know, places like the Pacific Islands, America. You know, before missionaries or colonizers turned up to America, Native Americans had, you know, multiple gender identities, more than two. You know, same with the Pacific Islands like Hawaii, same with South Asia, same with indigenous lands. You know, the idea of two genders is, if anything, a white concept. So we really need
look at you, you're schooling me, man. That's
what
you mean
right now. We need to educate. I think education is power. You know, once you're educated and empowered, whatever someone says to you, it's water off a duck's back. I'm not going to make myself feel uncomfortable because someone's uncomfortable about me. You know, like, 100%. That's a you problem. That's not a me problem, babe.
Yeah. I want to talk about the joy in our communities. MNEK, earlier you spoke about words like shade and tea and how we are able to steer the conversation. You know, we are able to be groundbreaking creatively in many different worlds. Where do you think that creativity in the queer community comes from, MNEK? Like, there's so much creativity in so many industries. You often see queer people, gay men, makeup artists, choreographers, in music. So, right, where does that come from?
Finding these qualities to do, or finding these like skills, are totally like survival tactics that we've known for all of our lives, as far as like just being able to exist with purpose, being able to exist with ambition. And I think, there's a certain like resourcefulness in it, in that there's been so many incredible people, so many incredible Black queer people especially, who have like played parts in the community that outlast even them. I guess, it comes from just that fire in yourself. And I think we all have fires in ourselves to want to do bigger things than us, you know? I think that as far as even me being a writer producer, I had no idea if there were any out writer producers or out Black male singers even. I really didn't have that to look at. Or at least I didn't even see like a spectrum of it. It wasn't like, okay, there's different types of Black gay men. It's not like this monolith of like what we're supposed to be. Yeah, I mean, all those things come into play as far as us finding where we belong and finding what is our thing and what we bring to the world. And clearly, absolutely, as we've seen over the years, it's a whole lot that the queer community, the Black queer community have brought to the forefront. I mean, look, I'm here making house tunes and all of this with Joel Corey, who we love, but house is Black and queer. So it's like, this is it. It all goes around in circles in some type of way. And house is the top of the charts right now every fucking day, but fronted by a white man. And there's a whole bunch of things we could say this about, like that we're doing every day. So it's like,
yeah. You see it in it, whether it's a TikTok dance or whether it's a phrase that has gone mainstream. People often don't realise where its roots lie. But I think, as a queer community, we'll always continue to be creative, because I think we're forced to find ways to express ourselves in this world that wants us to be quiet. Do you know what I mean? The world wants us to be quiet and to just exist quietly. And we find different ways to be louder, to be more creative, to be more seen. And I think we'll probably just continue to flourish that way. I love you both incredibly. Your presence alone means so much to me personally as a Black queer woman. I know it means so much to so many people in our community, whether they are out or otherwise. So thank you, man, for just living in your truth, for being visible, Dotty, for being amazing.
We love you too, Dotty, so much. And love, congrats, guys, on everything. Like, we've known you for years, and it's so beautiful to see you keep growing and striving and thriving and surviving in this big old industry. As a Black queer woman. So
thank you so much.
Bellissimo.